inspiring interviews with today's top landlords. This is the Rental Income Podcast. And now, Dan Lay.
I've got an awesome interview for you today. Joining us on the podcast today from Boston is Dana Bull. Dana has a great story. She set a goal that she wanted to buy 20 rentals by the time she was 30. And the awesome thing is she did it, and she did it while working a full-time job, and she's managing everything herself today. She's got a really, really great rental business going. So I want to talk to her today about how she found her properties, how she financed it, and how she makes everything work. So let's take a real quick break. We'll come back in 30 seconds and we'll meet Dana.
Are you on track to achieve your financial goals? Income producing real estate is the most historically proven way to accumulate wealth and has created more financial freedom than any other means. Norada Real Estate provides everything you need to invest in the best turnkey cash flow rental properties. Our simple proven system will help you create real wealth and passive monthly income. Get your free strategy session with our knowledgeable investment counselors at noradarealestate.com. That's N-O-R-A-D-A realestate.com.
Dana, so how did you get started in real estate?
So I fell into real estate. I know most people listening to this podcast, they are researching it and they strategically get into it. But for me and my boyfriend at the time, we just needed a place to live. And we couldn't find a rental that we liked. And it was just this idea of, why don't we buy? And when we started plugging in the numbers, it made sense. Mm-hmm. So we had a few properties, maybe three. And we had never bought a place before. So we were just kind of treating it like a rental. And we're like, yeah, it's good. You know, it has a sink and a toilet. It's fine. So we pulled the trigger on that, and it was a great decision. We were really happy there for about 18 months, and then I was itching to move to Boston, which was about 40 minutes south of where we bought the condo, which was in Salem, Massachusetts. So then our wheels started turning again.
And that's when you decided to rent the property out. Was it hard to figure everything out when you decided to put it on the market? Like to figure out the lease and everything else you need to figure out?
So when we bought it, we worked with an agent. So he gave us a few pointers. But at the same time, we weren't far removed from being renters ourselves, where we figured out, you know, what's desirable. I worked in marketing, so I knew that it's about, you know, framing and positioning the rental property so that we would attract the people that we wanted. And we had it rented out in probably about 4 or 5 days. My boyfriend at the time, he's now my husband, but he worked in staffing. So he's great at screening people and kind of getting a feel for if somebody's going to be a good fit. And so that part was actually pretty seamless.
Okay. So when did you catch the real estate bug? Was it when you got that first rent check that you decided, hey, we can do this again?
So what happened was we moved to Boston and we were in this great rental, and we called up our agent and we told him, you know, we really, really love it here. We're thinking about buying a condo. And he was like, okay, what kind of condo do you want to buy? And we told him it was a one bedroom plus office, and it was on for $650,000. And he was like, I'm not going to let you buy that. You're not buying that. And then he was like, look, we've got to talk about you guys and your strategy. You know, you're 23 years old. I don't want to see you spending your money at the bars. I don't want to see you buying some overpriced condo on a whim. So he was actually, I do credit him to getting us in the right mindset. Mm-hmm. And he really focused on kind of taking that step backwards in order to be able to take two steps forwards down the road.
Yeah, that's really kind of awesome, because I think most realtors would just jump at the chance to get a sale. So that's really awesome that he was trying to guide you. So yeah. Was he guiding you to buying another rental, or like what did he guide you to?
Yeah, he was like, you know, you should buy a three family. And at the time, this was the recession, so there weren't, surprisingly, people were holding in that area. People were holding on to their properties because they couldn't get the money. And there just weren't that many bank-owned properties at the time in our little niche market. So we ended up putting together an off-market deal on a two-family, and he helped us with that. It was a previous client of his. So he facilitated that. So again, we were still renting in Boston in our own rental. We were renting out our condo up in Salem, and now we just bought a two-family. So we're landlords and renters. It was just kind of a funny situation.
Right. Yeah. And so for that, the next property you bought for that second house, how did you finance that? Was that just a regular loan, 20% down standard type of loan?
Yep. It was super vanilla. So again, this was years ago and we were young. So banks, when they viewed us, they had about 2 years worth of data, which is the bare minimum. And the lending purse strings were still pretty tight. So I think we actually had to put 25% down in order to get that property. So that's how we did it. You know, it was vanilla. And I don't think for us, because we're super conservative, we've never leveraged like an FHA loan. We've never done a low down payment just because we want to have the equity in the properties. So even if that was an opportunity, which it wouldn't have been because we weren't owner occupying it, we probably wouldn't have taken it anyways.
Okay. So you bought that duplex and you didn't live in one of the sides. Like that was purely a rental.
Oh yeah. No,
okay.
You're still renting. In Boston renting. Yeah.
Okay. Wow. Yeah. Awesome. Mm-hmm. Wow. Okay. So now you've got two rentals going. Is this when you got kind of addicted to buying rentals, or like when did you set your big goal? Like you mentioned that you set a goal where you wanted to buy 20 rentals by the time you were 30. When did that come about? Like when did you set that goal?
So we were on vacation in Florida. We took off, I think like 3 days, 1 year. We worked like animals, and we like finally caught our breath, and we were on a very short 3-day weekend, and we were on the beach, and we were just like, what are we doing? Like, what is going, this is crazy. What are we doing? Do we like real estate? Do we want to keep building it? Does it make sense? And that was the turning point for us. That's when we decided, okay, yeah, we do. We like this. It's fun. We want to learn more about it, mm-hmm. and we really want to go for it. And so that's when we started to educate ourselves on, you know, I've never been huge on reading. I've listened to podcasts sometimes. I've read a fair amount of books, but I don't obsess about the educational piece because for me, I learn by doing. Mm-hmm. And I also don't want to, you know, I want to think creatively about what works for us.
Right.
But we did set some very rudimentary goals that definitely served as guidelines. And when we started thinking too far outside the box, these goals have really been helpful in reeling us in.
Okay. Now, how long has it taken you to get to, so right now you're at 21 units, and how long did it take you to get to where you are today?
So it took us, about 5.5 years.
5.5 years. So yeah. So you've got 21 units. How many different properties is that?
So one of them is under agreement. So we have 18 currently, and then we're closing on another one in the next 30 days. And that'll actually get us to 22.
22 units. Okay. So, yep. And how many properties is that, or how many different buildings?
It is, let's see. That's a good question. Six, right?
Six. Seven. Okay. So you were buying a property about every 8 months or so. Is that right?
Yeah. Or, actually I remember we bought a three family and then 2 months later we bought a four family.
Okay.
And we didn't buy anything for like a year.
Okay.
So it's been whenever we've been able to see the opportunities and we happen to be able to scrounge up the cash. It's kind of tied to Christmas time with year-end bonuses. Mm-hmm. And stuff
like that. Okay. So are you, the way you're buying the properties, are you saving up a down payment, saving up the 20 or 25% and then buying a property?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Plus the renovation costs.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, do the places that you've bought, have they all needed a good amount of work, or have you bought places that are ready to go basically as soon as you close on it?
We've bought one that was ready to go. To just experiment with what it's like having something like that. And it's great. Mm-hmm. But everything else has been a labor of love.
Okay.
So we've bought, our typical profile is a 3-family that's been owned by the same family for a long time. It might be an estate sale, or it might just be somebody that's really tired of being a landlord.
Okay.
Oftentimes they've let the property go in terms of management and in terms of maintenance. So what we find is a very difficult tenant situation, rents well below market, and then we have a house that needs some serious capital improvement projects and mm-hmm. attention paid to it. So that's kind of our profile. So we get in for what we think is a fair price. We're not getting bottom of the barrel. We're not cash buyers. So in our market, you know, we're not able to go in and snatch up the cheapest buildings because mm-hmm. there are plenty of flippers in our area that have deeper pockets and can
right.
do that.
Right.
So we kind of go after properties for a fair price. And then we will spruce up all the units, make them nice, make them shiny, and we'll defer some of the other work. Like, you know, we might know it needs a new roof. We might know it needs new heating systems. We might know the foundation needs pointing or some pump needs to be installed. But what we do is we fix up the units, get people in there. And then as soon as we have the rent coming in, we start funneling that money back into those other projects that need to be taken care of.
That's smart. So you're letting the property, the money the property is generating, you're putting that back into the property to increase the value and to make it nicer, right?
Right, exactly.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Now, is there any criteria that you're looking at when you evaluate a deal? Like, are you looking at the 1% rule or anything like that?
Yeah, so we have a couple of benchmarks, but the first thing is we're just realistic and reasonable about, we know what we're buying, and they need a lot of work. So we're not kind of penny pinchers when it comes to the numbers, because like any variable can throw off those numbers. So my first thing is, if I need to whip out a calculator to analyze the deal, it's too tight for me. Mm-hmm. But okay. at the same time, because we're not dealing with a big building, there's so much room for error. And my criteria is less about the numbers and more so about a vision that I have for the property.
Okay.
So for instance, like they might be marketing it as a 1-bedroom, but if there's a formal dining room as well as an eat-in kitchen, can I turn that formal dining room into an extra bedroom and now market it as a 2-bedroom?
Right. Okay.
Does the property, you know, we're buying in one of the most historic neighborhoods in the country. So it's Salem, Massachusetts. So, you know, can we lean into that story of the property and kind of weave that into our marketing when we're pushing it to potential tenants?
Yeah.
You know, like I usually research the history of the building, and people like to know what the story is, because
right.
these buildings are sometimes they're 200 years old.
Right. Right. Yeah. So there is a lot of history there. And are you able to get a premium? Like if you find that something cool happened in that building, are you able to maybe get a little bit of a premium or maybe get it rented faster by having that story?
I would say it's just a little add-on bonus.
Okay.
Like, wow, that's so cool. You know?
Right, right. Okay.
It's kind of like a little closing point.
Yeah. Now, how about finding the properties? Like, where are you finding your deals? Are they off the MLS, or are you out there trying to find deals some other way?
So I wish I was really cool and had all these off-market deals. And the thing is I do have people that come to me with off-market. But a lot of times it's their bigger building. So it's a, you know, a 5-unit. And then at that point, you know, I have investor clients because I'm also a real estate agent. So it's more for them, or they have partners, and that's kind of their approach. But in general, MLS, you know, I'll never be looking for a property at the same time I'm helping a client, because I don't ever want to compete, because that's not fair.
Sure.
But in our area, for the smaller property, so, but you know, a duplex to a fourplex, I would say that most of them are sitting on the MLS. There's definitely situations where a cousin sells property to a neighbor or his cousin. So there's a lot of that where you just have to know the right people and hit it at the right time.
Okay.
But I would say you'd be crazy not to put your place on the MLS right now.
Right.
Let the market have a frenzy over it.
Yeah, there's a lot of buyers out there. Now, you live about 40 minutes away from your rentals, right?
Right.
Has that been difficult at all, like to manage the properties where you can't just pop over if something comes up?
Yeah. So actually, kind of going back to the beginning, we ended up leaving that rental in Boston because we bought a 3-family and we moved into it and we needed to be on site to fix it up.
Mm-hmm.
So we moved back to Salem for a couple of years. And so for a while, as we were building our portfolio, we were living in the same town, which was super convenient.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, I got that itch to move back to Boston. So we ended up buying a 3-family in Boston and moved back into the neighborhood that we love. I will say that there's pros and cons. I don't particularly love living with my tenants just because it's like a little too close for comfort. You're just so accessible because they know where you live.
Right. Right.
And also I'm a little bit of a perfectionist. So if I drive by my house, one of my properties, and it doesn't look the way I want, that bothers me.
Right.
And so it gives me a little bit of separation, out of sight, out of mind. You know, if there's ever a huge problem, they're going to call me, I'm going to know about it. So it just, that separation I think is healthy. But at the same time, you know, filling vacancies is tough because I still do all of my own rentals. So I've got to drive up there for showings and all that kind of stuff.
Do you try to schedule a couple of showings at the same time, or like do an open house, or are there any tips you could give anyone if they maybe have a property that is a little bit far away from where they live?
Yeah, I think it depends on the time of year. So it depends if you are marketing from a point of strength or a point of weakness. So for instance, if it's February, I know that I'm marketing my rental from a point of weakness, right?
Right.
The demand is lower. I'm going to have to bend over backwards a little bit in order to accommodate other people's schedules, especially the potential tenants that seem like a perfect fit and seem great and qualified. Whereas around the springtime all the way through September, there's just so the rental pool is so great that I can kind of send the message of, all right, you guys kind of have to work around my schedule. So yeah, I used to do a lot of open houses in the June to September timeframes. And if you can't make it, you know, sorry, you couldn't make it. But definitely in the winter, I need to be a little bit more flexible.
Now, can you give some advice for maybe someone that's just getting started? And I mean, you've bought a lot of properties and you have a lot of units, but someone that's just getting started that sees, you know, God, Dana's got so many properties, I could never get to that number. Like, is there any advice you could give them on how they can get there, or some steps that they could take to get moving?
Yeah, definitely. So, you know, just because I don't use low down payments doesn't mean that that's not a great option to take advantage of. I have a ton of clients. That's how they get started, is they do an FHA loan, or they might qualify for some sort of low down payment conventional. You know, here in Massachusetts, we have mass housing. Depending on your income, you might be able to fit in that parameter. So I would say look into that, weigh out the pros and cons, see if that's going to work. And you might be able to, oh, so here's a big one. You know, if you're young and you're getting started with this and you're not married, and you and your girlfriend, if you're serious, one of you could take out a loan on one property, low down payment, and the other on another. And you know, you figure it out, the logistics of that. That's another strategy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I would say other people partner, you know, bank of dad, if your parents want to get in with you on this.
Mm-hmm.
But the other thing is, like, I've always had multiple jobs. So if numbers seem really tight, you know, hop on Craigslist, try and pick up a little part-time. Maybe there's a writing job, or maybe you could be a secret shopper. I mean, there's right. So many ways to just have a side hustle,
mm-hmm.
and it adds up. It does. Really does. Yep. Especially if you consistently work an extra, even just like 8 hours a week for 3 years straight, there's your down payment right there.
Right. Right. Well, yeah. I think that's really, really great advice. So Dana, tell us where someone can reach out to you. You mentioned that you're a realtor in the Boston area. Tell us your website, or, you know, where people can track you down online.
So my website is danabullrealtor.com. You can Google my name and you'll find me. And then you can shoot me an email. I'm on LinkedIn. I'm strangely not really on social media. I don't know why. I've never been a big fan, but I'm pretty accessible through email.
If you missed Dana's email address and you want to look it up, you can find it at rentalincomepodcast.com/episode140. I also want to thank our sponsor today, My Landlord Helper. You can find out more about them at mylandlordhelper.com. Thank you so much for subscribing to the podcast. I'll be back with a new interview next Tuesday. My name is Dan Lane, and this has been the Rental Income Podcast.